Okay. Lady Jean Bromet. Now, at any point, if you want to just...
Yes. Well, I send my greetings to the Alcady Plainsmen, and amongst your membership, particularly to John Lellenberg and to Milt Perry and to Stan and Renee Cormack. I'm sitting here in my flat now with John Tibbetts, and he's been telling me a little bit about your special Scarn branch of the Baker Street Irregulars. I know there are lots of branches in America, but it's so nice to have this opportunity to talk personally to one of them. I believe you're stationed in Kansas City, and I remember going to Kansas City with my father and admiring that splendid statue of the Indian. That was in the early 1920s, and I'm quite sure that Kansas City looks very different today. But how nice that your interest in Sherlock Holmes remains.
Lady Bromet, in talking with you, why don't you first introduce yourself and your relationship to Sir Arthur Conan Doyle and tell us a bit about where we are sitting, what day this is, right at this point in time?
Well, I am Jean Conan Doyle, and I'm the youngest child of my father, Sir Arthur Conan Doyle. He had two children by his first marriage, Mary and Kingsley. Kingsley, alas, died in the First World War, and Mary died about 10 years ago. And then I had two elder brothers, Dennis, who died in the 1940s, and Adrian, who died in 1970. Dennis died in the 1950s. One rather loses track of these sad things. Anyhow, that's the family. I'm the only one left. And I have a flat in London, which is near Harrods and near Sloane Square, very good shopping centres. And today we're sitting in my what used to be called drawing room, but now can only be called work room because everything happens in this room. It's the dining room and the sitting room and the television room, and most important of all, it's my office.
Now, to your left is a very imposing portrait of a gentleman in military uniform. Tell me about him.
Ah, that is my very beloved husband, who died 5 years ago. He's Vice Marshal Sir Geoffrey Bromet, and after he came out of the Air Force, he was governor of the Isle of Man for 7 years. And then afterwards, he was in charge of air raid precautions for Coventry, which was a city that didn't want to run its own air raid precautions. And the government decided that they really must have them. And my husband was put in charge of that.
Flanking the image are two swords.
Yes. That's very observant of you. The smaller one is a naval dirk, which was his dirk when he was at Dartmouth and he was in the Royal Navy. And the other one is a replica of the sword of state at the Isle of Man. And this was presented to him some years after he retired, and we were very touched when it was sent to us.
On the opposite wall, almost as if you were looking at each other, is a portrait of you in younger years. If you would tell me about the circumstances of that.
Oh, one really shouldn't have a photograph of yourself in your own drawing room, but it means an awful lot to me because I served on for 1 year in the Air Force after I married. And during that time, I had to be out quite a lot. And on one of my visits away, my husband had this portrait painted from a photograph. And this was to be a very surprise first anniversary present to me. And I was so touched because I never thought that anyone would want to have a portrait of me. And then suddenly to be given one, my once very dear husband, was indeed a wonderful surprise, and I'm certainly not going to take the portrait down now.
Would you please tell me about the young woman that we see smiling out at us from that canvas? What was she like in those days?
Oh, I wasn't so young. I was director of the Women's Royal Air Force. And I had lots and lots on my plate waiting to be done. But I loved it. I loved working with people. I got an enormous admiration for the men in the Royal Air Force and indeed for our own women in the Air Force.
At that time, was there a greatly developed women's corps, or were you a part of establishing the women's component of the Royal Air Force?
No, of course, I'd been in the Air Force for 28 years. I'd been through all sorts of different phases of the Air Force. But by the time I was director, and before that, we had become a part of the Royal Air Force, and my commission was in the Royal Air Force, not into the Women's Royal Air Force. There was no separate service. It was just a convenient term to show that we were women and that in certain respects we might have to be treated differently from men because of different physical stature. But But in the early days, of course, there was a separate corps, which was the Women's Auxiliary Air Force. And I belonged to that during the war. I joined before the war.
At that time, was it still rather unusual for a woman in uniform in that branch of the service?
Not really. I mean, when war broke out and we women were sent in sort of detachments of 50 or so to various RF stations, you did come across some of elderly men who were very shocked at having women and wouldn't allow them in the officers' mess. And one friend of mine who was made the mess catering officer had to have her meals behind a screen in the officer's mess all by herself. It was ridiculous. And I think of that and think that now that I, later on, I lived in a senior officer's mess and for 2 years, and I was the only woman in that mess.
As Air Commandant, do I have that title correct?
Yes.
As Air Commandant, I would assume then that a great many men worked under or for you.
Not particularly as air commandant, but they did when I was commanding a station, when I was a group officer, a group captain. And then, indeed, I had rather more men on the permanent staff than women, and a lot of national service men for whom I had great admiration. And they seemed to find life in the service very interesting, so much so that after they were demobilized, they used to come back at weekends and stay on the camp. They had sort of reunions every so often because they all admitted it was one of the happiest times of their lives.
At what time, then, did you separate from the service, or have you maintained connections?
Oh, I retired, as one does, with a pension, in 1966. But since then, I've had quite a lot of work with welfare organisations connected with the services. One was, first of all, the Victory Club in London, where service people can stay for a very small amount of money, and it's a very fine club. And then I was a governor of the Royal Star and Garter for 14 years. And that's for disabled men, and now, recently, they're opening their doors to women, too, but badly disabled men, and some from the Somme and battles of the First World War, and some, alas, from Ireland and the Falklands. And that was fascinating work, because they are such splendid people, and they don't complain, and they make one feel very humble, really, to realize that we complain about little things, but they don't.
I hear in your voice a genuine concern, then, for continued public service.
Yes, I don't look upon it as public service. I just look upon it as something one does very naturally, and that is a great privilege to know the people who are disabled. And they're very kind about talking to one and telling one about their quite extraordinary experiences.
Let's go back to the war years. I'm assuming that many of the men that you would have worked with during the war would have known your father. Is that correct?
No, they didn't. And I must say that during the war years were the only time that I was ever reminded that I was the daughter of my father. Now, during the war years, I would sometimes be called and found Dr. Watson or Suki or something like that. But this was all from short-term officers, and I didn't really mind it. But when we got down to the nitty-gritty of the permanent Air Force, all this stopped. And people knew me as myself. And in fact, on the day when I was leaving the Air Force and went round to say goodbye to some of the more senior officers, one of them said, having just read the newspaper, I had no idea you were related to Sir Arthur Conan Doyle at all. And that's how it should have been.
How about your husband's feelings in that regard? When did he first become aware that this woman he was interested in was the daughter of Conan Doyle?
Oh, he always knew. And he wasn't a great reader, but then he made a point of reading a lot of my father's works.
How did he handle that? Did he kid you about it? Or did he feel like, well, enough people at this time are calling you nicknames, that he would respectfully withdraw from that kind of comment?
No, nobody was calling me nicknames in those days. This was just a short-term thing during the war. He didn't mind at all. He always backed me up when people came to interview me and see me. And it always amazed me that here was this man who was so distinguished in his own right and had done so much for the country, and just the sort of man that my father would have admired most, because he did admire the military people very much, and particularly, I think, men who made their names in the aviation. And people would come, and my dear husband would be so courteous to them as the host, and yet people were not interested in him and his life at all. And my father would have been very embarrassed by this. And I was embarrassed for it. But my husband was such a big man that I never once heard him complain about it. And nor did I ever see him feel in any way put out that this was happening.
At the same time,
he was a very big man.
Yeah, at the same time, maybe you were a little put out once or twice.
Oh, I would be on his behalf, yes.
Oh, interesting.
Well, people in this world get things so topsy-turvy.
When you were a little girl, where did you grow up? Let's see, you were born in 1912. You were the...
In December.
the only daughter of the second marriage, correct?
Yes.
Okay.
I was born in December. Yeah, there was another one born, but I think she didn't survive.
What part of London or outside London did you grow up then as a little girl?
Oh, I grew up at Crowborough in Sussex, which was my father and mother's house. When my father married my mother, he bought this house at Crowborough and built onto it. And we lived there for the whole of our lives, and for the whole of up to my mother's death. And at that time, it was taken over by the Canadian Army during the war. And then after that, my brother Dennis owned it, and it was sold.
I know you're asked this many times, but yet growing up, you must have become gradually aware that there was a very famous man that you happened to call Papa, living
Pop.
In that house. Pop?
Pop.
Tell him again. What did you call it?
Pop. Pop. But I don't think we called him Pop until we went to the States on one of the lecture tours. Then we always did. My father loved slang, and he liked American slang very much and encouraged us to learn as much American slang as we could while we were out in America. And though he didn't use much slang himself, he was really rather intrigued that we should learn slang. My brothers both spoke most impeccable English, most beautiful English, but I'm afraid I did pick up this leaning towards slang. And then, of course, being in the RAF, well, a lot of RAF slang during the war, I found this very lively, and I got very used to using these words, and which my father would have approved of thoroughly.
I understand that when he would be writing, that he would then sometimes read his works to you. Do you have recollections of that?
Oh, yes, very, very clear recollections. Because from the time I was a schoolgirl, he used to bring his whatever he was writing down at lunchtime. When we'd finished lunch, when he finished lunch rather quickly, and he'd go up and collect his manuscript that he'd been writing on during the morning and come down and read it to us. And then he'd always say, now, if there's anything that you don't like in this, if there's anything you object to, say, tell me. And so we listened to this, and one got to learn one's father's own feeling about these characters. I mean, he had an affection for Holmes, there's no doubt about it. And it amused him intensely to write in little Holmesian jokes, rather dry humour, and Holmes pulling Watson's leg. And he used to laugh about Holmes's conceit. It was called conceit, well earned. I mean, it was quite justified, his conceit. But he loved to write in a little bit about Holmes, and then he'd chuckle away at that. He chuckled a lot over the Holmes story.
He never confided in you at times some of his impatience, though, with the character. We do know, of course, that there was that occasionally.
Oh, yes, but that wasn't exactly just impatience. I mean, that we all knew. That he would prefer to be writing a historical novel and or doing some other writing. And that is a fact. And then he did resent the fact that Holmes took up so much of his time and that so many people concentrated on Holmes and didn't talk about Brigadier Gerard and Professor Challenger, who, in his opinion, were just as great characters. And we all, as a family, loved them just as much as Holmes.
I was going to ask you, as a young reader, were you also reading these, or were you secretly reading other works by other authors on your own?
No, I was reading Holmes stories under the bedclothes, as most children did. And so I read those, and then I read my father's other works, of course, Brigadier Gerard and Lost World, and his short stories, rather macabre short stories and things. But of course I read masses of other books as well, because I was a great reader, and at that time could read very fast. And so I didn't just concentrate on Conan Doyle.
I understand that he took you to a stage performance of The Speckled Band.
Yes, he did. He took all of us to that in 1921. And we loved it. That was terribly exciting. And he was very pleased with it. I expect you know the story, that when they first put it on, and I think it was 1910, they first put it on, that they used a real snake. And there were so many complaints that they were using so obviously a false snake. They had to redraw the real snake and use a false snake. Too silly for words.
I'm wondering if you could give us a portrait of what he looked like and especially what he sounded like when he would come down the stairs and read to you these stories. What remains in your mind and in your ears as you think back to that?
Well, as I think back to that, I can hear very heavy footsteps, slow, heavy footsteps descending the stairs. And then this large, wonderfully genial figure coming into the dining room. We were all there already. And then it would be as if the sunshine had come into the room. He was such a personality. And everything took a light then. And everything became so interesting. His talk became so interesting. And he wasn't particularly interested in food. He had very, very simple tastes. Apple dumpling was his favorite pudding, and sort of roast beef and Yorkshire pudding he'd love, or steak and kidney pudding, those sort of things. He wasn't interested in that very much in that, and not very interested in drinking much either. But
and then the voice itself.
The conversation would start. This deep voice, when one hears it on these records nowadays and tapes nowadays, it sounds so much squeakier than it was, because I think of faulty technicalities in those days. And another thing, too, was that one of them was taken in one of the two of the last years of his life, in which time his teeth, he had a great theory that everyone should have their teeth out very young, and then nobody'd have toothache. And he'd had all his teeth out very young. By the time he became in his late 60s, these went fitting quite properly. And this blurred his voice a little bit. It wasn't quite the same as it used to be. And this comes over in the records. But he was a much more full-chested speaker than you can hear on the records.
And I understand that your own dog became something of a movie star.
Oh, yes, Paddy. And he appeared in some of the still photographs, too, because when I was away, my father looked after him for me. This was a special thing. And he attached him to my father. And they were very fond of one another. And Paddy, who was an Irish terrier, used to go around with him, and so in every photograph, he would be with my father.
Now, the last years with your father, what memories do you remain with you now of maybe the last time that you had moments alone with him?
His thought for other people. He was so upset. He sat in the room waiting for oxygen for his heart and so on, while my brothers went off to get the oxygen. And he said, it has been reported that he said it to somebody else, but that wasn't true. And he said to me, get a book and read. It's so boring for you, and I'm so sorry for you. You're there, and this must be also boring for you. And, of course, he loved my mother very deeply indeed, and he was sweet to her. And he was just wonderful to all of us until he was unconscious and died.
Now, you were about how old at that point?
I was 17.
Very impressionable age.
It was a terrible blow to me because I was particularly close to my father. I loved my mother dearly, but I think it's fairly usual for daughters and fathers to be closer, and mothers and sons. And it certainly happened with me. He'd given me so much companionship. We used to spend, when I was on my holidays, every evening together. We used to sit and round the early radio set trying to get some message or other from the BBC. And we sat and read together, and I was allowed to go in his study and read while he was working.
So he did not mind people around him while he wrote?
No, he didn't. He wouldn't have liked people around him who talked to him. I can't remember other people going around him, but there was a special chair which I was allowed to go and sit in, and I didn't talk at all. I just sat there and got on with my own business.
And also,
I looked after his library. I dusted all his books for him, and I could do that while he was working.
Did he ever work at a typewriter, or was it strictly longhand?
No, always longhand, and such very neat longhand.
Where,
Have you seen any?
No, where are the manuscripts? What do you have?
I could probably show you some replicas here in one, two books, which will show you them. But I have manuscripts, a lot, but they're in the bank.
Where they should be.
Yes.
However, behind us, to my right, is a library. Now, you say many of these are his books.
Yes, great, great number of these are his. And a lot of them have inscriptions to him from people like H.G. Wells and Barrie and so on. A lot of them. And another lot are marked by him. He's marked the interesting paragraphs. And one or two, I think, are prizes for him when he was at Stonyhurst College. We had the three of us, my two brothers, myself, divided his library up between us. And I was given first choice, and first one, then another brother, and then another brother, and then me again, and that sort of thing, which means that I was able to get the books that I wanted myself. One of my brothers sold his section to one of the American universities. I think it's the University of Texas, but I may be wrong.
Now, directly across from you on the wall is a very famous image of your father. I feel like I've seen this many times before. What can you tell me about it?
Well, the awful thing is my memory is so bad that I've forgotten the artist's name. I think it's Gates, but I'd have to verify that. We had the artist went down and saw my father quite a lot down in the psychic bookshop, when my father had this bookshop which he ran as a hobby in Victoria Street in London. And Gates then took a lot of sketches from it and then a photograph, and then he painted from that. And then at one stage I had two. This one, and one far less formal one, a smaller one, far less formal, which I really wanted to keep because it was more my father than I knew him. I mean, that's when he's lecturing. And
in his right hand are glasses. Now, tell me about the glasses. Did he not wear them very often?
No. But at that stage of his life, for reading, but not until then. And he just put it on in case he had to read some notes, I suppose.
Now, that famous, formidable mustache, as a little girl, you must have been fascinated by this, as any child would be, I would think.
I wasn't. You see, I can't remember the one when it was black and waxed. I was too young for that. But this one, I didn't mind in the least. I mean, a lot of men with moustaches in those days, you see. It wasn't just him. I mean, my uncle had a moustache. Both uncles had a moustache and so on. There wasn't anything really odd about it.
Now, among all of the children, is it safe to say that it is Adrian Conan Doyle who pursued the most literary bent?
Yes, it would be. He wrote... At least he wrote one pastiche of Sherlock Holmes stories, and he wrote, I think, two about his own adventures and fishing, deep-sea fishing. Dennis, on the other hand, wrote many, many articles. He was a good journalist, and he wrote many articles for Sunday papers on the subject of spiritualism.
Indeed. Now, the spiritualism was something that must have been discussed in the house a lot during your years.
Yes, it was.
Is that something that he ever communicated to you especially, or was it just an interest that you would believe in or not believe in as you chose? Or was he emphatic about...
To all of us at different times, he talked to me about spiritualism when I was about six, and said, you know, you mustn't worry about death and what death is, and this is not the end of everything. There is another life afterwards.
It is interesting that even for those who don't believe in that, in his books, that indeed was true.
Yes.
When did you become a dame commander? For those of us who are not aware of what a dame commander is or what she does.
Well, I was just lucky enough to be in the Air Force and to have risen to be the director of the WRAF. Because, not now, but until fairly recently, the directors of the Women's Royal Air Force were appointed dames, either on retirement or on appointment. Mm-hmm. I was very lucky because I got it shortly after my appointment.
Now, when people refer to you, or when you refer to yourself to people, is the term Dame Commander more proper or Lady BROMET?
It isn't Dame Commander. If I'm using the name Conan Doyle, it's Dame Jean Conan Doyle. But the full title is Air Commandant Dame Jean Conan Doyle, which shows people that people often wonder why I should be a dame. Was it something to do with Sherlock Holmes? Well, no, it wasn't. It was an air commandant. I was a military dame. My medal is marked as a military one, you see. And so it's helpful, I think, sometimes to make it quite clear that I'm not an academic. I'm not a politician. But I am a servicewoman. And that's the dame.
This is a separate interview for the Green Room. 3, 2, 1. And welcome to the Green Room. I'm John Tibbetts. Come on in and join me. I'm in London, England. I'm broadcasting with Air Commandant Dame Jean Conan Doyle. She's applauding because it's a mouthful for those of us that are unaccustomed to all of the titles that can come in front of a name, but few people that I've ever talked to more deserved all of these titles than Dame Jean Conan Doyle. We are in her apartment in London, and we're talking about, among other things, your father, Conan Doyle, and Sherlock Holmes, and your own childhood. But I think it's important that we note that in 1980, something happened regarding the Sherlock Holmes stories. I'll let you describe what happened and what the results have been, because we've sure been seeing the name Sherlock Holmes around a lot lately, but your father's name is not attached to it.
No, that's very bad. Well, in 1980, the works came into public domain in this country, and anybody could write whatever they liked, put on any sort of show or anything in this country, and write pastiches using the characters. This doesn't apply in America, I'm glad to say, where, thank goodness, your laws have been changed fairly recently, and quite a number of my father's works are still in copyright, and they're in copyright to me. Over here, there have been several pastiches written. More and more recently, I'm afraid to say. And there have been a lot of films have been made. But we, by having a right, a copyright on the film, on my father's works in America, I hope to influence the standard of work that is produced here in England, because most people want to either publish that work in America afterwards, after it's been published in England, or they want to have it produced on the American stage or screen. And I won't give permission for that to be done unless the characters are shown in character and in period and are very well written. Well, for a time, I did allow pastiches to be published on these terms, but always against my inner judgment, and I don't allow it any longer. I allow a certain amount of films and television and cinema if they follow the rules I've just told you about.
Let's take as an example The Secret of Sherlock Holmes, now playing at the Wyndham Theatre in the West End here in London. When this project came up, were you consulted at first, and if you would follow it from there?
Yes, I was. I was consulted very early on, in that I was asked to a private view on a Sunday. I was sent the script. I heard it on a tape, and I kept in very close touch with the author, Jeremy Paul, and with the star, Jeremy Brett. And I could see nothing objectionable in it at all. I thought it was a very elegantly written little play, fascinating in its way, something that I think would amuse my father greatly. He didn't much mind what liberties were taken on the stage, within reason, providing they were in good hands, the hands being William Gillette. I don't think he would have been so happy with some other actor producers. But certainly with The Secret of Sherlock Holmes, it's been beautifully handled by people who obviously love Holmes and Watson. And the acting is splendid. Jeremy Brett's been appearing as Holmes in films for the television for a long time now, but his performance has changed beyond measure. I didn't really like him in the early series. He was far too arrogant and too mannered, too highly strung altogether, whereas Holmes was a very cool character. And it has been wonderful to see the change in him, and that the last series, instead of being a rather unpleasant man, he became an endearing man, in spite of his conceit, in spite of this, that, and the other. He's somebody who you really care about. And I think it's an absolutely great performance. He holds you.
I wish I could have been present in his dressing room when you went back to see him.
Oh, it was a lovely party. Very nice to see him again. And such a privilege to meet Watson, because Edward Hardwicke is a splendid Watson, just the sort of Watson my father would have envisaged. Unlike Nigel Bruce, who really was the most appalling Watson ever. I believe he was a very nice man, but Watson was never the old bumbler like that. I mean, Holmes would never have shared digs with a fool.
Now, by contrast to all of this, has there been a project that has come your way that you've had to say no?
John Lillenberg, who acts as my agent, has certainly had to say no on my behalf to many projects. Yes. And there have been, but in this country, a book has come out recently which I think is highly objectionable, but of course I can't do anything about it in this country. And that is a book produced by some homosexual society. I think they've got some rather inappropriate name. And I think that is absolutely disgraceful to suggest that there was a homosexual relationship between Holmes and Watson. There was never any such thing.
So in general terms, you are very aware then of a role that you must maintain in the 1980s to keep the Holmes character with some kind of integrity. How would you paraphrase that? How would you describe that role?
Well, I am a protector of Sherlock Holmes' reputation and therefore my father's literary reputation. It's a funny thing because Holmes, I'm not a Sherlockian. Holmes is not necessarily my favorite character. I would fight just as strongly, if not more strongly, for Brigadier Gerard and Professor Challenger. But I have an affection for him. Like my father, I find him to be a terrible nuisance. He takes up far too much of my time, and I can well understand my father wanting to push him over right and back forth. I can quite feel that way myself at times. But what I can't be happening is I have grown up with an affection for the this character who I feel I know so well, and I hate to see other people putting him in their books, which are not nearly so well written, and really denigrating.
And besides, how could you come back to your apartment and look at that image of your father on the wall without, with a direct gaze, had you not been so careful?
Oh, you're quite right. I couldn't. No, it's a pity that people will try and write these pastiches, because I always feel that a writer who's worth anything should create their own characters. What an admission that you must use another man's characters in order to get a book published. And really, and to allow these very special characters to be handled by writers who can't produce their own characters. What a fate.
Dame Jean Conan Doyle, I want to thank you so much for your time and your observations on keeping Holmes alive and well in the 1980s. It's been a pleasure seeing you and sharing the library and the images of your father and your late husband. And on behalf of Sherlockians everywhere, thank you so much.
Well, I've enjoyed meeting you enormously. As you know, I was rather hesitant about seeing you today because I'm so busy going off on holiday. But it's been a very great pleasure to meet you, and you couldn't have made it easier for me to have this interview.
I appreciate that. Broadcasting from London, the apartment of Dame Jean Conan Doyle. This is John Tibbetts in the Green Room. I'll talk to you next time.